In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Congregation may be seated. Well, I am not sure whether the Holy Spirit came to my house first and then went to Mike's, or went to Mike's house first and then came to me, because we're preaching on the exact same thing. How's that work? You know, the story is told. The story is told about a priest who went into a fifth grade Sunday school class. What, 10 years old, I think, 10, fifth grade. And the priest decided to teach the fifth graders about the sacraments, and particularly teaching them about the Holy Eucharist. And so in order to give his fidgety students something to hold and to look at, he gave each of them an unconsecrated communion wafer. And the priest began his explanation in age-appropriate manner about how the bread and wine that the priest takes becomes the body and blood of Jesus. After the prayer of consecration, the bread and wine become the body and blood of Jesus. And Jesus is really present in this body and blood, in this wafer. And when the priest had finished his brief age-appropriate explanation, he asked, does anyone have problems believing what I said about the Holy Eucharist? And one little 10-year-old boy raised his hand, and the priest nodded understandingly. It's hard to believe that Jesus is present in that little piece of bread. We have to have faith. We have to have faith to believe that it's true, that it's a miracle of God, a mystery and a miracle. The 10-year-old nodded his head and said, but no, Father, I believe everything you said about Jesus being in the bread and wine. I just don't believe those little white things are bread. The Apostle Paul writes, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Amen. Our little boy was more than willing to believe that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, took bread and said, this is my body, and then the bread became the body of Jesus. But the little boy was reluctant to believe that the priest knew anything about bread. Several years later, I was in a Bible study class with adults, and the study book they were using stated that when the Bible talks about faith, it means a relationship to God. And one person in the Bible study kind of objected to my definition. Maybe objective is too objecting to that was too strong a word, but he was pondered about, he thought that faith was believing things that you could not prove or had evidence for or had not happened yet. So if that is what his understanding of faith was, why does the Bible study say that faith is about relationship? Well, consider this. Consider that you're standing on a dark, lonely road waiting for a ride. And you believe that you will be picked up by a friend. Your faith is focused on the relationship with the person that you asked to pick you up. If you don't know the person, or if you know the person to be unreliable, then you will doubt. You will worry if you will really be picked up. But if you have a close relationship with a reliable person, then your faith is something, your faith in something that has not yet happened will approach certitude. Years ago, when my children were younger, I told them that I would pick them up after school. They would go to the place we agreed upon, and then they would wait for me. My children would do this because they knew that I loved them and that I would never abandon them. For years, they went to the pickup line and waited. And for years, I picked them up. Faith is about relationship, reliability, and the admission that I cannot do it myself, that I have to depend on something or someone outside myself. While you're mulling that over, I'm going to digress for a moment to make a point about faith and tell you about one of my favorite books, one that I've read more than once, by one of my favorite authors, Barbara Tuchman. I think I've read all of Barbara Tuchman's books. The book I'm talking about is Guns of August. The Guns of August. I don't know if any of you have read it. If you haven't, you should. The Guns of August is a story about the beginning of World War I, but years prior to August 1914. And for many years before that, France and Germany had been spoiling for a fight. The German military had been preparing for war with France. The French military had been preparing for war with Germany. And it was easy for everyone to see that the German military had a larger army, had bigger and better guns, and was involved in rigorous training. The French military was outgunned, outmanned, and less militaristic. But the French generals were absolutely confident of victory should war break out against Germany, because they believed that they had something that Germany did not, that would more than make up for the deficit of guns and troops and training. What was the French secret weapon that provided their margin of victory? The French generals believed that they would beat a superior German army because the French soldiers had elan. Elan. It's a complex French word that encompasses things like enthusiasm, patriotism, spirit, vigor, the will to win. At the outbreak of World War I, the French generals ordered their troops to attack superior German forces. And the results are well known and tragic. Wave after wave of French soldiers would rush German lines only to be mowed down by machine gun fire. The reaction of the French generals was unconscionable and tragic. They accused their troops of cowardice and of not showing enough elan. It tragically took tens of thousands of deaths of Frenchmen charging machine guns with bayonets before the French military generals conceded that it was their strategy and not their men's elan that was at fault. The French generals had placed their faith in the wrong place with tragic results. Now, I digress to tell that story to make this point. All faith is not religious faith, faithful faith. The object of faith is God and God's will. And it is not enough to say you have faith because you really, 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 really believe something. Faith is subjective. Now, I'm the first to admit that subjective and objective talk in the context of faith can be confusing. Objective knowledge is not the stuff of faith. You know, once something is proved objectively, it no longer requires faith. Faith is subjective, but it has a proper object, and that is God. Strong faith in things other than God do not make you a faithful person. The gospel tells us every time people placed their faith in Jesus, Jesus came through for them. He was always reliable, always faithful to his promise, always loving, always forgiving, always reaching out, until finally, even the most skeptical began to realize that the only conclusion is that Jesus is God. Now, you can have faith in a lot of different things. You can have faith in your money. People with a lot of money tend to rely on their money. They even have a pretty good relationship with their money. At least they spend a lot of time with it, investing with it, trading with it, protecting it. And the same goes for business connections or family connections or intelligence or education. All those things may be somewhat reliable and afford a somewhat satisfactory relationship. But when they fail, where will you turn and what will you do? Let me suggest you place all your faith in Jesus. Then, despite your money or connections, despite your education or your career, you come to this altar rail and you get on your knees and you extend your empty hands and ask God to fill them with himself. And you take that little wafer of bread and admit that only Jesus has everything that you need, and that everything without Jesus is as nothing. And for your faith in Jesus, Jesus will show you unconditional love, give you eternal life, and answer all of your prayers. Amen.